be all welcome to this plenary session, Crossing Boundaries Through Technology. We kindly ask you to switch off your mobiles. The session will include two presentations. After each presentation, you will be able to ask questions. Please see that there are two micros in the room. And the first presenter is Thomas Moeslund and Professor Arnold Baca, the president of this Congress, will address some words about this first speaker.
Thank you, Natalia. So this session is on technology in sports. There has been enormous development throughout the last years in technology in general and in computer science in sport in particular. Just think of the miniaturization of these sensor technologies, of these pervasive computing technologies, which are ubiquitous in all areas and become more and more ubiquitous in all areas of sport. Think of the possibilities to capture position data, for example, in soccer, which helps us to analyze in an automated way the tactical behavior of teams. So also the issue of the big data, we are able to collect so many data which will help us, hopefully, to get needful information out of this. And one particular area is computer vision in sport. And I'm really proud that we have a top expert in this area here at the ECSS conference, Professor Thomas Moeslund from Denmark, who is working at the Department of Architecture, Design and Media Technology at Aalborg University. He has been teaching in this university since 20 years, and one particular area of his research is computer vision. Professor Moeslund is the head of the Visual Analysis of People Laboratory, which conducts research on how to build systems that automatically sense people and infer information about them. He is the editor of the book Computer Vision in Sports, which appeared quite recently. And let me give you just the title of one of his publications. So the paper, A Survey of Advances in Vision-Based Human Motion Capture and Analysis, was referenced. I just looked it up again, 2,177 times. So I really look forward to his presentation. Thomas, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for inviting me here. I do not have a sports science background. I have a computer vision background, but we are moving into the sports domain also. So apologies if I say something that is not completely correct on sports. The agenda I'm going to follow today has four items. First of all, I'll have the assumption that perhaps not everybody knows what computer vision is, so I'll say a little bit about that. Then I'll move on to say a little bit about what are the commercial systems that are actually already out there using computer vision, and just try to give you a kind of an overview over those. Then I'll dive into give you some examples of the research done within computer vision related to sports in our group to just give you a taste of what we're working on. And finally, some concluding remarks. So before we can understand what computer vision is, we need to relate to what is human vision. And human vision is this phenomenal ability that we have that you're without any doubt, unless the light is slow or you're sitting too far away, you have no trouble at all seeing that I'm holding up a bottle here, right? And you can follow it around and stuff like that. And we know pretty well what's going on. There is a lot of photons in the air in here. They're bounced off this object into your eyes where they're gathered. On the back of your eyes, you have your nerve cells, which do a little bit of interpretation of these signals and then send them to the visual cortex in the back of our head. We have a pretty good understanding of what's going on in the eyes and also the nerve cells within the eyes, and a little bit knowledge of what's going on here, and then it starts to get a little bit mystery. So really not quite sure what the brain does, you know, as in other fields. But if we then turn to computer vision, that is basically to say, how can we digitalize this process? So now the camera becomes the eye, the lens becomes the front of the eye where the actual light or photons are gathered. And then normally in a camera, you would have a small chip which would actually basically count the number of photons entering, which is simulating the nerve cells in your eyes. And then these data are transferred to a computer. And this is, of course, where the magic goes on. This is where, in our world, what we call artificial intelligence, where we try to replicate some of the stuff going on in the human brain. If you take an image and you try to zoom in as far as you can, then at some point, I mean, you cannot get any closer and you're down to pixel level. So ultimately, an image is composed of pixels. Each of these pixels is basically just a number, basically saying how much light was exposed on this exact position in the chip. So basically, computer vision or image processing, as it's also called, is basically about making sense out of these numbers. So to us, images are just numbers, and videos are just a sequence of numbers. I sometimes bring along this small cartoon joke when I'm giving a talk about computer vision. And that is to say that when I'm talking to people who don't necessarily have a background in computer science, engineering, or computer vision in particular, then it can sometimes be difficult to comprehend why is this difficult. Again, the example before, you have absolutely no trouble recognizing this as a bottle. But this is actually very, very difficult for a computer. And that can somehow be hard to grasp. I mean, if I can do it, then come on, make the computer do it also. So computer vision is actually very, very difficult. But the good thing about it is that compared to other branches of engineering, is that we know it can be done because we know the humans can do it. So basically what we're doing in some sense is to basically try to pull out the algorithms that we have in our brain and put them into computer, so make the computer do the same in software and even go beyond that using 3D and stuff like that. Okay, so now we know a little bit about what computer vision is, then let's try to see how it's being used out there currently in commercial sports applications. And some of the information I've used here is from my good friend Graham Thomas, who run one of the research divisions at the BBC. And I guess you can look at this technology in sports from a number of different viewpoints, and I mean at least two are listed here, and one would be from looking at it from the performance point of view. You know, you for example, you take your new favorite sport watch that can measure all kind of fancy things. You go running or whatever you do, and you upload that data, and you get some statistics and some comments on your diet and blah, blah, blah. So this is basically, you know, focused on the individual to help us improve the performance and understand, of course, the performance. Make us better in training and rehabilitation, stuff like that. Then there kind of is another view of where technology comes in. And this is where we actually are, you know, where we sit as spectators to be entertained by sports. And one of the big events going on right now, I guess most people would know that, at least those interested in football, that would be soccer if you're from US, that is the European Championship. And a game is like less than 2 hours, but still it can last for an entire day. You would have like 3-4 hours of, you know, warming up where you have experts telling stories and blah, 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 and post-event analysis and stuff like that. And all that is about the story, right? The 2 days ago, we had this actually great semifinal between Portugal and Wales. And these are countries playing against each other, which are fine. But this was sold as, you know, the class of giants. You have these two fantastic players, Ronaldo and Bale, playing for each opposite teams. And in their daily life, they actually play for the same team. So you have these friends coming up against each other. And it's like, you know, the gods that are tormenting, even it's football. I mean, and all this is fine. And all this we're being, of course, this that we're being engaged in this story. One of the key things there is statistics. We love statistics. We're way beyond, you know, how many goals have you scored? Now it's, you know, how many successful passes have you had and headers and stuff like that. And all that, we have people sitting around, you know, manually annotating all that data online, getting it out there so you can also bet on it, you know, and make money and stuff like that. And that's fine doing that manually. But of course, if you want to roll kind of that out, you need technology to help you. Otherwise, you will drown very soon. So this is one of the key entry points in sports of technology as I see it. And the first thing with people like me who are interested in computer vision, of course, getting the video. And then we have seen a very interesting deployment of different camera technologies in sports. And I mean, 10 years ago, who would have imagined that this spider web, that is the camera flowing above a football field, that you would allow that, right? I don't know, those of you who follow skiing would see that they have tried to do the same in skiing, just with a drone who almost crashed on top of one of the skiers. But anyways, but you also see that in other sports. You see, actually, in skiing, you also get cameras inside the poles. And in cricket, you get these thumb cameras inside also to get all these views. Some of the referees and some of the team sports also have head-mounted cameras. So you can actually see when they're confronted by it and all that, just to enhance that. So, but when we do have the images, good or bad, then as I see it, there are at least these four different areas where computer vision can play a role to kind of enhance this feeling of being a spectator. These are, the first one is this, the augmented reality, which I guess is perhaps the most successful one. This is where you basically take some information and you overlay that directly on the video feed. The other one is analysis, and you, for example, pick out how far has a person run, and you present that statistics to the viewer. Then you have this notion of, in sports, where you're doing more or less the same thing, the different athletes, you can kind of overlay, you know, the two spectators at the same time, so you get a visual impression of what's going on. And then the last issue is this, we do have a lot of cameras covering these sports events, but of course, we don't have infinitive amount of cameras, so we can only select the viewpoints of the cameras we have, unless we go ahead and synthesize stuff, so you can actually take your camera and put it wherever you want. And let me give a few examples of each of these four. So the augmented reality is, as I said, probably the most well-known technology where computer vision and of course, computer graphics are combined to enhance this experience. And some of the stuff can, of course, it can be used for different things, but imagine, for example, when you, for those of you who are interested in swimming, this notion that you can actually have this line that follows the swimmers and saying, if you want to beat the world record, you have to be ahead of this line. So you can actually, sitting there at home, you know, feeling, oh, come on, come on, come on. And this, of course, goes on for all different types of sports to kind of enhance what you see. And the key to make this work is that we know exactly what the camera is looking at. And that is normally done in one of two ways. For those stadiums where you would have all the big games, you would have very expensive camera hardware, and you can solve this mechanically. That means that you actually have measurements, so you know, if I tilt my camera like this, pan it like this and tilt it like this, then I get readings back, so I know exactly where it's positioned. And I have the same with zoom, so I know exactly where I'm zooming in. So I can take these readings, and then I know exactly which part of the field I'm looking at, and then it's relatively easy to overlay some graphics. This is far from always the case that we have these fancy cameras. Sometimes we just have ordinary cameras. And there the trick is to make this work, is to kind of use computer vision to identify certain characteristics known as features in my world. So you get the software to find certain characteristics, and you kind of track them as you, for example, pan your camera. So you all the time can, you say, okay, that point at that when I zoomed here, that till it panned here, that point was there. Now I'm there, and the point is here, and I can make the correspondence between these two points. And if I have those calibrated to the environment, then I basically know more or less exactly what I'm looking at. The problem here is, of course, that these feature points illustrated here can come from, you know, many different things, and some of these things are moving, which of course makes life very difficult. Okay, turning to the scene analysis. This is speaking about football, which is of course very popular right now. This is the data you get while watching, saying that this particular athlete has been running for so and so many miles. This is partly done automatically and partly done manually with people who annotate online. But you do have fully automatic system for stuff like that. This, and here is an example made by Hawkeye for cricket, where the ball is tracked by six cameras, high-performance cameras, so they can all the time track where the ball is. Based on that, you can get a 3D position of the ball within the stadium, and based on that, you can, of course, do all kinds of statistics, you know, where that particular player normally throws the ball and spin and all that, and you can overlay that, and you get additional information, and so on and so forth. This is another example taken from the Olympics in London, where you have this. I mean, if you watch diving, then it's you watch them dive, and if I guess at least me, I have no insight to diving, so it's pretty hard for me to say if it's good or bad. And then you have a bunch of referees who put up a sign saying I don't know 4 point something or 10 or whatever the scores is, and then you can see if it was good or bad. So the notion here was, but can we somehow take the assessment criteria that are in the referee's head and try to give them to the viewers? And at least two of the things they're looking at is the angle the person have when entering the water and the amount of splash, you know, and these two things are of course related. So computer vision was used then to find, you know, what is the angle when you penetrate the water. This is what is illustrated here very intuitively. And also this is the splashometer, which it was denoted, which basically measures, you know, the amount of splash using computer vision also. So this is not, of course, used by the referees, or perhaps it is, I don't know. This is, again, just to tell that extra story to the spectators so they feel more engaged. In some sports, you have the athletes doing exactly the same thing. I think the first time I saw that was when you have the trial runs in Tour de France, where you followed, so you basically, as a viewer, what I was seeing was the screen was split down and I could see the two competitors, you know, head to head, how you can read their facial expression and see who was suffering the most and stuff like that. And that has been taken beyond that now, where you basically use computer vision to take, again, you use the technique similar to before, so we basically know exactly where the camera is. If we know where the camera is looking at, we can gradually build a model of the background, right, without athletes. So then we know basically what the scenes look like. Then when some new video comes in with an athlete on, we can more or less pixel by pixel compare the two and then kind of extract the foreground, which would be then the object or here the athlete running. So then you would have the foreground. Then you could basically take that person and put in to another video sequence where you know the camera is located the same position and at the same time in this running and jumping stuff. And then you can, you know, again, this is not for the referees at all, this is for the spectators. So then you can basically compare in the same video feed, you can have as many as you like, but beyond two, it becomes a little bit crowded. So you can basically, you know, do your own analysis to see, does this look good or bad or better or worse and stuff like that, and learn from that, of course, also. Okay, the final example of something, again, football, but this is used in other sports also, but is this notion of, very often football comes down to one key incident, you know, did he touch the ball with his hand, was there an offside, was the ball across the line, did the linesman have the good enough view to see it or not, and we of course, if you have a camera in the right position and the cameraman is very quick to zoom in, stuff like that, then of course we have that evidence directly as a viewer, right? But we can only have so and so many cameras in the stadium, so there is a trend towards having this virtual camera. So basically building a 3D model of the scene in real time, that's hard, but we're trying, and then basically stop time and then take the camera wherever you want to and see whatever you would like to see for this, whatever is interesting for this particular event. And how that is done is that you would have, for example, here three camera inputs, and you know exactly how these cameras are related to each other from a geometric point of view. Then you would do some computer vision to basically extract the foreground, similar to what I talked about before. And then you would take each of these persons here, find that person in each view. That would give you multiple views from different directions of the same object. That allows you to do triangulation, and that ultimately allows you to do 3D reconstruction. So basically what we would have is a 3D model of the world. Then you go back to the original image and you take the texture and you kind of glue that on top. So from one viewpoint you get texture here, another viewpoint you get texture there, and then you kind of blend this texture, this is, yeah, blah, 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 computer graphics, and then basically you would have a virtual 3D representation of your scene. And the moment you have that, then of course you can do more or less what you want with the camera. So we can stop time, we can go wherever we want to do, and we can see it from whoever's perspective we want to see. This particular incident is about an offside, whether or not there was offside. And yeah, there was offside. And it was actually called by the linesman. These are actually pretty good. So, yeah. And this is being advanced, of course, and also used in it takes some time computational-wise to do this, so this is also very popular in post-game analysis, where the computers have some time to digest all this data and generate all this nice 3D imaging. Okay, so let me run into a little bit about what are we doing in our research group. So I run this lab focusing on computer vision, and our specialty is to look at people. And basically, we are working around three research questions. So the first is, oh, sorry. Wrong button. So the first question is there anybody out there? That's basically, you know, detecting people, extracting them, tracking them, counting them, stuff like that. The second one is, who are they then? This is also known as biometric. This is basically using computer vision to recognize these traits that are unique to each of us. You probably know DNA from TV series, but you also have fingerprints, your face, the front, the back of your eye is unique to you. The way you walk is not completely unique, but within a certain constraint, it's also unique. Your ear is actually also unique. The only thing that changes is gravity kind of make it longer over time. And then the final question is, what are they doing? This is extremely difficult. It's actually also difficult for humans to answer sometimes. You know, what are other humans doing? You know, what are the mood? What activity? Is it a dangerous situation? And stuff like that. But let me give you a small example of where we have how we had worked with the first and the third question in relation to sports. This was a practical problem. I don't know how this is in other countries, but in Denmark, well, in Denmark it rains a lot, so we need a lot of indoor sports facilities in order to perform sports. These are normally booked once per year, and the different sports clubs, they are very keen to get a lot of time, so when you're looking at these booking schedules, they're completely booked. All arenas are completely booked. And then the sports clubs complain that, well, but I need more time, and yeah, but you can't have that, so we need to build new facilities. Not going to happen, because if you actually go into one of these arenas, you will see that it's only half the time that's actually full. So there is this difference, you know. It's due to the sentiment structure and stuff like that. Anyways, they asked us, could we build a computer vision system that could actually all the time count the number of people in these arenas? Sure. When we started working on this, a journalist then wrote an article that the municipality is now surveying a citizen, and there was a picture of a small boy in his shorts Yeah, and I didn't particularly like that story attached to me or my group, so therefore we started to use thermal imaging. Thermal imaging are special cameras that measure body heat. You've probably seen them from helicopters that look for people in the water and stuff like that. So then we don't have this privacy issue anymore. So we do a computer vision stuff similar to what I said before, to kind of get the persons out of the scene. Then we have to deal with all kind of crazy scenarios. You know, people are occluding each other. If you have loose hanging clothing, then you would not have a complete heat profile, and you would be cut in two or three parts. And it also turns out that the material that you actually use on the ceiling, or sorry, or the floors in most of these arenas, that actually reflects infrared lighting heat. We didn't know that. So that means that people kind of cast shadows. So we had to deal with that. So 2 years of PhD work, and then ultimately we solved these problems. So we're now able to count rather accurately the number of people. This is just a plot of how well it worked for one particular scenario. But I think the key thing here is that it works with 95% accuracy. And this is not just one of these lab tests we did Friday morning. This has been tested. We always test 2 weeks at the time, full time. And it has been tested in 200 different arenas. So this is a very, very well-tested system that is now being sold. Okay, so while we were at this, somebody also asked us, but would it be possible to also say something about what's going on in the arena? I know if I look in the booking, it says it's football. But then if I look in, they're actually playing badminton. So could I get a sense of what's actually going on? We need data, right? We are in the age of data. So, okay, sure. So we tried that. So we know where the people are from what we just did. Then we made a mathematical model that basically maps from the camera to the floor of the arena. And that basically means that you can project the position and image down on the floor, right? And you get images like this. So if you kind of look at that over time, then you will get these kind of heat maps where you can see where people are actually positioned over time. And then in the end, what we did was to say, if you take 5 minutes of this and kind of average it together, then you get some kind of a footprint or a signature of the different types of spots. Then they actually look rather different. Which is perhaps not surprisingly, because depending on the sport you're playing, you move in different patterns, right? And you occupy different occasions in the field. So these are some of the popular sports in Denmark: badminton, basket, handball, soccer, amateur volleyball, where you have three teams playing, and this is professional volleyball. This is actually also interesting to see the difference between. So, yeah. So I guess somebody like you could learn something from this. Anyways, so we built the mathematical models about this, and then we built models about what is not one of these characteristics. So these are random exercises, gymnastics, I'm not 100% sure. And then whenever we have new video coming in, take 5 minutes, find the position of the people, add that over time, get these signatures, and then see which of the models of these models it matched the best. And this allows us to end up with a recognition. It's actually 95% now, I'm sorry I didn't correct that. But around 90 or 95% accuracy, we can actually say what's going on in the arena. And we can do that pretty accurately, actually. The problem is sometimes during transition from one sport to each other, where you have some warm-up session, something like that. That's tricky. But when you're actually doing a sport, we can actually rather accurately say that you're doing this sport. Okay. So what I have done now is basically to go through some examples from the lab and from the commercial world, and then I'd like to conclude on this note, the saying that computer vision is fantastic in the sense that compared to virtually all other technology out there, you have to mount something on the human body. Computer vision works at a distance. So you can do without interfering with the athletes. Clearly, computer vision has a major role to play in the world of tomorrow. Just look at the amount of cameras being deployed. You all have it in your phone and blah, 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 blah. the self-driving cars that we will soon see in the street, the robots that will soon invade our homes and stuff like that. And I also think this is true for sports. And if I had to look a little bit into the future, combining computer vision and sports, I think some of the things we will see more of is we have better and better and cheaper video and tracking technology. And this means that we will have more metadata. Now it's not, in a very near future, it will not only be these top athletes' movements we will analyze, it will be everybody's movements. It's already starting a little bit when you, as I said, you run and you can upload your data and stuff like that. But I think we will see this technology deployed in schools also, simply to gather a massive amount of data. And I think that would allow us to get more insight into understanding sports and in general. But it would also mean that we can deploy some of these methods on recorded footages. So basically, you could have these algorithms run on all the, again, football World Cups that have ever been and annotated them. And then that basically means that afterwards, you would be able to go to Google and search, you know, give me all the people who are left-footed and scored a goal with their right foot or something like that. So we'll just have this searchability. Then I also think another thing will happen is the biomechanical technology. I mean, if we walk around here, we can see a lot of examples. And as it is right now, these are, for most sakes, they are special setups. Either you have to wear something or you have to be in a special lab or a clinic. And I think we'll see more and more of this moving out into the unconstrained environment, into the fields. And my personal dream here is that you will actually be able to measure, again, football, when two people are interacting, measure the forces. So all that, you know, where people, it seems like they're being shot, you know, and you filming that, you can get rid of that. I would really like to see that. And lastly, a thing that has also started to happen is that for many years we've been focused on the individual players, and now there is a trend towards looking at teams because we have these massive amount of data and they're becoming easier and easier to get by. So this team analysis, so learn something about, of course also to understand what's going on and to improve performance, but also to automatically detect events, for example, that, again, annotating all this data, now there is a corner, now there was a goal and all that. So all that could be automated at all levels in sports, not only the top level. Yes, and I think on this note, I will say thank you for your attention.